三鞠躬。
Liu Xiaobo, the writer, poet, scholar, dissident, and Nobel laureate, has died. A week after his death, a group of his close friends gathered for a memorial service in Beijing, with national security agents watching their every move. Officiating at the proceedings was Liu Xiuli. Like Liu Xiaobo, Liu Xiuli was very active in China's academia in the 1980s. Neither of them fancied living in an ivory tower. They became comrades in arms at Tiananmen Square in Beijing on the 4th of June 1989 and subsequently went to jail.
We once sacrificed, but we survived. Because I was the 6th of August, the news agent's spokesperson. You see, that time we were so young. 大约是他第三次出监狱，我们在一起坐监狱。后来我们出狱以后，然后他就是不断的被抓捕，我不断的找人，然后他出狱以后去接他。
Liu Xiaobo was, by all accounts, a student of exceptional promise. Just in his early 30s, he had already earned a master's degree.And a doctorate at Beijing Normal University. In June 1989, he was a visiting scholar in the United States when the so-called Tiananmen incident happened. He decided to return to Beijing to join the ranks of the demonstrating students and subsequently initiated a hunger strike.
1989年5月27号嘛，正在吃中饭。小波冲进来了，他比较魁梧啊，然后那个时候也年轻啊，再加上呢他刚从美国回来，穿的一条牛仔裤，他这一身装束在当年很时髦嘛。
看看这只黑手。
Liu Xiaobo was found guilty of inciting counter-revolutionary sentiments. In prison for the first time, he buckled under the authorities' urgings and wrote a note to express contrition for what he'd done at Tiananmen Square.That moment of weakness was to prey on his conscience for the rest of his life.
他自己说他懦弱、胆怯了。我觉得他比太多的人更诚实、更有自省能力。此后的这个28年，他实际上是走上了一条就是自我救赎的道路。
有很多默默无闻的学生四名死在枪口下、刺刀下、坦克履带下啊，而我呢跟他们比，我幸运得多，我是幸存者，尽管被蹲进了监狱，但是我毕竟我还活着。我觉得呢，我对这些亡灵负有一种不可推卸的道义责任。
Released in 1991, Liu Xiaobo dedicated himself to publishing articles on human rights and democratic reform. For his efforts, he was the subject of non-stop surveillance. Then in 2008, he was jailed again for drafting the famous Charter 08. Ironically, during his 11-year sentence, the honor of being a Nobel laureate was bestowed on him.In 2017, news came from the authorities that his liver cancer had already progressed to its final stage. He was released on bail on medical grounds. All the information about Liu Xiaobo came from just one source, the authorities.
医院本着人道主义精神，全力救治。
3 days after his death, Liu was cremated and his ashes were disposed of at sea.Only afterwards was a meeting arranged for his family to meet the press, apparently to quell rumblings that the way Liu's ashes had been disposed of was against his family's wishes.
我首先要感谢党和政府，完全按照我们家属的心愿。
我们看他亲哥哥整个的那一场表演，他是一个傀儡。其实那小波先生跟我谈，他们已经差不多30年没有任何的来往。虽然是亲兄弟， 但是我们看到这个集权体制对这个亲情、对这个人性的这个扼杀。
Yu Jie, a dissident residing in the United States, was one of Liu Xiaobo's best friends. The two of them were working shoulder to shoulder in 2003, when Liu became chairman of the independent Chinese Penn Center. The author of Liu Xiaobo, a biography, Yu is currently in Taiwan, working on a collection of Liu Xiaobo's works.
This is my Xiaobo.
就比如说我们有一次我们差不多把重要的维权律师差不多都请来，像那滕彪、那朴志强、莫少平等等。
In 2003, Liu Xiaobo was trying his hardest to promote democracy and freedom of speech in China. He actually managed to form a nucleus for dissidents and human rights activists both within the country and abroad.
不管是不是我们的会员，只要有作家因为这个言论那获罪，他都会去帮助。他甚至在外地的作家被抓以后，他甚至坐火车去那当地，去他们家里面去见他们的妻子或者父母，然后他甚至把自己的稿费那给他们。这花费的不仅是钱，而且是最重要的时间和精力。那我在这里。
Yu Jie was one of the first to endorse Liu Xiaobo's Charter 08, a document on such universal values as equality, freedom, and rights. For this charter, Liu Xiaobo was found guilty of inciting sedition. He was incarcerated for the fourth time.
本身他的这个文本非常的温和理性。那小波说得很清楚，不是写给政治局的那几个人看的，是写给中国的公民社会看的。他曾经说一句让我很感动的话，他说我们虽然在这个不自由的这个国家，但是我们假装我们生活在一个自由的国家，想写什么就写什么，想说什么就说什么。如果我们所有人都能够像他那样做了，虽然那共产党这个架构还在那里，但是我想那个公民社会的景象一定不一样的。
他也没太辽宁吧宪章的这个，他就没太当回事儿，是我感觉。
非常敏感。
对，我是有。
你跟他说过吗？
我跟他说了，他说我神经病。
因为我们最后一面是2008年的12月，结果他被捕的那一天，他是从我们书店走的，到我把他40送他走。
For a month preceding his arrest in December 2008, Liu Xiaobo had been visiting Liu Xiuli's bookstore every day, signing copies of Charter 08. To Liu Xiuli's eternal regret.It so happened that on the night his learned friend was taken away in handcuffs, the two of them had just parted after an acrimonious argument.
就是我们是吵了一架分手的，主要是对08宪章的看法。它首先是个政治文献，因此所有和它有关的动作都是政治行动。如果是政治行动的话，那么应该怎么办呢？有后续的考虑没有？还是仅仅就是说是一个？我们拿出一个文本，然后签上名，这个事就结束了。
最深刻的就是他结结巴巴跟我讲，你不满意，你自己起草一份呢。当然，他说的就是，他说他不是这么说的了，你不满意。你就自己起草一份，这本是我给他开 开的那个很重点的一本书《国家为什么会失败》，对，我还特别让刘霞跟他讲，要好好读这本书。
Because of the Tiananmen incident, Liu Xiuli lost his university lectureship. He went on to open this bookstore in Beijing and immediately had Liu Xiaobo and his wife as members of his regular clientele. After Liu Xiaobo was incarcerated in 2009,He made it his mission to maintain a steady supply of books to jail, with Liu Xia acting as courier on her visits.
每一次开书单，我要花很长时间。我希望他能够更全面的了解，这个通过出版物而了解现在外面这种各种研究的变化、思想的变化。我想趁他有这么多年呢，这个能够在里头。至少就是出来别变傻了，就是。哎，
宋总，你看，又给他拿了一捆笔。
啊。
两个大本子，这个我特别喜欢名字，我也喜欢这个。这本《此地无人生还》，这个月又买了60本书。哎呀，他老不出来，这书架就很快又都满了。
这张照片在一个日本餐厅，去年的夏天，4月1号，他的在他的生日，他的生日那天晚上照的。对，那天来了有20个人，到这个时候他人基本上还算是比较正常。
For Liu Xia, her husband Liu Xiaobo's becoming a Nobel laureate was more of a curse than a blessing. She was put under house arrest. Her younger brother was sentenced to 11 years in jail for crimes of fraud, which she publicly said were fabricated. Physically, she was found to be suffering from a heart condition as well as depression. But friends who wanted to visit her were confronted by an intimidating police barrier.
He said, sometimes he lay on the bed.望着天花板，经常想，就是说，他说，我房子外面的那么多朋友，他们人在什么地方？哎，怎么没有一个人来救我呢？有一段时间，他们为了惩罚刘霞，就不让他到锦州去探视刘晓波，你知道吗？就把他带走了，从他那个家带走了，就不让他住在他家里。为什么他那个家里老来人吗？在楼下晚上的时候，拿那个电棒啊。
我们来他们会给你压力吗？会骚扰
你，他们都跟我们全家人都
去干。但是外边人对你的关注会。
对刘霞行为，我渴望逃离。没想到刘晓波同意跟我和刘辉一起离开。拜托你和朋友们为我们奔波。刘霞，2017年4月20日。
Excerpts of a letter Liu Xia wrote to Lao Yiwu, a poet living in exile in Germany, 3 months before news that Liu Xiaobo was critically ill. Liu Xiaobo did have the opportunity of being released on bail to go abroad for medical treatment, but he kept declining.
He was in the news that Liu Xia had a severe depressive disorder and heart disease. After that, because he didn't allow him to talk about this situation.后来这次他突然知道了，他就是觉得他心疼他的妻子，他妻子也没啥政治头脑，他为了自己的牺牲了他的妻子，他觉得感情上说不过去，因为他知道他要死啊，趁着他最后的生命，把他妻子送到德国。
Liu Xiaobo wrote Liao Yiwu a letter 17 years ago. To this very day, it still touches the recipient to the core.
他那封信，17年前就说中国需要一个悼念巨人。
天安门的这个角度来说，当时人们很有良知，结果到后来这个天安门屠杀之后，几年之后就转头去挣钱去了嘛，大家。但是他这个就是需要一个道义方面的巨人，一直走到今天，他终于成为他信章中写的那个人。
The death of Liu Xiaobo has been headline news in Hong Kong as well as overseas, but it is news people on the mainland cannot openly discuss. It is also impossible for anyone outside to contact Liu Xia, the widow. Despite the fear of clampdown, there have still been a number of low-key commemorative gatherings on the mainland. Some participants have been charged and held in custody.
哎，我是鲍总啊，我现在有关部门就是来告诉我不要谈刘晓波，他现在就在我这坐着，
就现在坐在你旁边呢。
11号下午4点，就是刘晓波所住的那个医院，穿着印有刘晓波头像的文化衫。13号早上，我被国保拦截，然后带到档案接待中心关了2天多。在这个问题上，表达自己的态度，不论形势有多艰难。
For all the hardships that came his way, Liu Xiaobo never lost his belief in pacifism.Defending himself for the last time in court, he was armed with a statement he had written himself. The title, I Have No Enemies.
我看到一个很可悲的现象，就是因为长期跟黑暗斗争，所以自己也被黑暗所伤害，然后变得跟那个反抗的对象越来越相像。
Yu Jie, the writer who is effectively living in exile in the United States, finds many resonances in Liu Xiaobo's statement of having no enemies. Not many on the Chinese mainland share his sentiments, however. They think pacifism hardly stands a chance against a powerful authoritarian regime.
From 中共这个建党的开始，整个中共夺取这个政权、维持政权，就是靠这个煽动那仇恨，这个不同阶级的这仇恨，包括他们党内的这斗争。我们不能靠这个愤怒、那仇恨去那解决问题。小波先生他也说，他说比勇气更重要的是这个耐心。我想，可能我们要用一辈子甚至两三代人的这个力量去走完这一段路。
将近20年的时间，你注意一下看一下，就是说当政者重点打击的主要是这些温和派。因为你温和派还有一些做事情的空间，把中间的力量你全部消灭干净的话，对不起，你只能是面对随时可能跟你作战的就是那股力量。那么好，你只能面对的是革命。
那边是海峡对岸，我看到跟中国相连接的这个大海吧。当然，我是想到那刘晓波先生他的那骨灰在这个大海里，那个我没有敌人的这个观念。越是他的希望这个渺茫的时候，我觉得要守护这个小小的那火苗。
这一场震撼人心的死亡，不是说像闪电一样能够成为一座长明灯，不仅让更多的人能看到他，并且能够指引很多人的生活方向，指引很多人奋斗和斗争的方向。